Welcome to Hopkinton Coffee Break, your home for current community talk, with Patricia Duart, Darlene Hayes, and Connie Wright.
Hello, and welcome to Hopkinton Coffee Break. Look who we've got on the couch today.
Full couch.
A full couch, absolutely.
The comfy couch.
So some of you might remember about a year ago, we had Joe Markey and Mike Sullivan on.
Shepard.
The same.
Forgive me. Mike Shepard on talking about the new elementary school. Well, things have moved ahead. So we've got guests talking about that today, a member of the school committee. So I'll let them introduce themselves and reacquaint us with who they are and their role in town. So, Joe.
Thanks, Patricia. It's great to be back. I'm chairing the Elementary School Building Committee, and we have an exciting update today. So thanks for having us.
Well, and a little bit about, you live in town, you and your wife, you have three children.
Yes,
and
I do.
You're involved in a lot of things.
Right.
So,
thanks.
You know,
right. Yeah, we've been here. We moved here right before my oldest daughter was born.
We
were assured there was going to be a new kindergarten by the time she was in kindergarten. She's now in eighth grade. She'll be in high school next year.
Yeah.
So she'll be a sophomore when the new school opens.
Right.
We have two additional kids after my daughter. So we've had three kids since moving here.
Yeah. So your youngest might be able to... Well, should be able to.
Yeah, my youngest is five. He's in preschool.
Right.
So we're on track that he could be going to the new school for first grade.
Yeah.
So we're excited about that. Okay. My wife is a photographer in town.
Yeah. We've used her professionally. In fact, we've got an email out to her. We are adding somebody to our website, and she's going to be taking his photograph.
Yeah. But we love Hopkinton, right? We live, work, and play here. Yeah. So it's a great place to be.
And John.
John Graziano. My family moved to Hopkinton about 7 years ago,
mm-hmm.
Right before my oldest daughter started kindergarten.
Okay.
So it was just the decision of we wanted to pick where we were going to raise our kids, and we love this town. I have three children. My oldest is just started middle school. I have a son in the Hopkins School in fourth grade,
mm-hmm.
and our youngest is a first grader at Center School.
Awesome.
So we
have three different buses to get on.
working from home this morning to come do this. Yeah, it's a constant rotation of you walk one out to the bus stop, you walk back, you get the next one, while my wife Erin kind of gets them ready, gets them fed breakfast.
I remember
it's the
that.
Transportation.
And,
yeah.
and when you finally get two on one bus, you're celebrating.
Right.
Because,
and that is the only combination of having three different buses.
And I lived that too. And oh my God, you just felt like you spent an hour and a half to 2 hours because between getting them ready. And then they come back on three buses, so it's the window gets narrow.
Yeah,
Since you guys moved here, have thrown yourselves into the committee.
I was how long have you been on the school committee?
So I am in my fifth year on the school committee.
Wow.
So this is in sort of the middle of my second term. So I ran for the school committee after having been here about a year. Again, when we moved to the community, it was just we wanted to move to a community we could be a part of and be an active part of helping grow.
Mm-hmm.
My wife Erin is extremely involved in the community as well. She's been involved in the HPTA since we moved here, and she's actually now president of the HPTA as well.
Oh,
so. You know, we don't see each other a whole lot, but but we try to coordinate the kids' schedules as best as possible.
Absolutely.
So,
and Mike Shepard is
yes.
With us too.
You can pretty much say I never left town. Both my wife and I graduated from Hopkinton Public Schools way a long, long time ago.
Someone just got inducted into Hopkinton, just top of the hill.
Oh, the top of the hill thing. Yes,
he's in the Hall of Fame at Hopkinton.
Yeah.
Shortly after we graduated, I went to college. Karen went to nursing school, and when I graduated from college, I was in the Marine Corps, and I was in the Marine Corps for 6 or 7 years. And we had some duty stations. You know, I was in Vietnam for 13 months. But ideally, when I came home, they stationed us in California, which for us seemed like.
Yeah. Right,
this is the greatest place
There's
in the
us.
World.
Yeah.
And after California, they transferred us to Hawaii, which even got better.
Oh my God! Wow.
So about that time, I was going to get out because my first and second son, Matthew and Brennan, were born, And we really wanted to move back to town. And so we did that. Then we adopted three more children, Devlin, Zach, and Sarah. And we, like I say, we pretty much never left. I taught school in Weston for 6 or 7 years, and then became a building contractor here, and then became a building inspector here, and then went to the building commissioner in Brookline. And everybody said, you're really, really old now, you should retire. So I did. And so I worked part-time for the town as a building inspector. Mm-hmm. I have now the beauty of having five children is I have, now I have 10 grandchildren.
Wow.
And some are in the school system.
I love it.
All but two are in. And but most of my kids live in town. And in fact, after this, I have to pick my granddaughter, Olivia, who just turned 16, took her last final today. So my job is to pick her up, and I'll bring her out to breakfast at the Spoon or something. So, but the town is always been great, Karen and I, and we, you know, our philosophy is you know, nothing is for nothing. You have to give back. So we've been on a lot of stuff, and
so you three are quite busy with this newest project, the elementary school.
Yeah.
So let's talk about that.
One of the exciting parts was there's actually a shovel to the ground.
Okay.
Yeah, we had a ribbon cutting.
Yeah, we had a groundbreaking end of October. That was exciting.
So where are we? As someone whose children are grown and gone, and you know, admittedly, while I'm generally aware, just not as intensely aware as if my children were coming up. Just tell us more about, you know, what's happening. We see the space. We see it. You know, where are we in the process? And
I do spend a lot of time up there. As you know, when we had the groundbreaking, I'm old and retired, so I have nothing else to do. And the site, as you know, was the former Irvine property. And when we had the groundbreaking, most of the trees were gone, and it looked like a big pile of dirt. Mm-hmm. And since we started back in October, most of the site work is done. They've done most of the infrastructure for the Conservation Commission. They've done, the sewer lines are all in, they're tied into Hayden Row Street, the water lines are in, they're all tied in. The parking lots are all laid out. There was significant drainage structures under the parking lot, so that was a lot of, you know, time and effort.
Kind of green.
And they're working on the foundation now. The foundation is probably 75% to 85% done. Mm-hmm. One of the good things is when you're in the building business, it's always the unknown things. You see a big pile of trees and you don't know what's under that.
Right.
So we thought, like the usual Hopkinton issue, there's going to be lots of water, and then where there isn't water, there's going to be ledge. And we didn't find either of those things,
good.
Which worked out really well for us, mm-hmm. and helped us in our time.
So you're sticking with the timeline.
Yeah,
it's going
and
well.
Yeah, awesome. We're sticking right on the timeline. We have a great contractor in Cole Antonio, mm-hmm. and they, you know, when we initially set this up, the site work, the fellow that got that contract, Marbury, said, "I'm going to put 40 guys on this," and they did. Mm-hmm. And you can see by all the equipment out there that they've been right on it. Foundation guys as well. Mm-hmm. So. You know, we're in really good shape.
So I think the school committee must be excited.
Yeah, I was going to say we're very excited, and one of the things that I was thinking as Mike was given this update is when we talk about the preparations for the school and the way the project is going, we focus really on the site and the building. Mm-hmm. But I'd be remiss not to highlight as well that Mrs. DeBoe and her staff at the center school are also doing a fair amount of planning for the fact that this. The school is going to be opening in 2 years. We actually just closed the school committee budget cycle, and one of the things I commented on to her was the next budget she presents to us is actually going to be the first budget in that new building.
Yeah. Wow.
So there's a tremendous amount of energy and excitement in that building. We had mm-hmm. teachers actually attend the groundbreaking. They're very excited for the opportunities that the new building is going to afford them as educators.
So now we have this underway, and there were some decisions made at town meeting around the schools, but we have special town meeting coming up, and you guys are on it for a couple of reasons, and let's talk about that and why and where
we
are and
attention
how that
to.
You know what's going on.
Sure. Yeah, so Article 2 is a request to fund additional 4 classrooms and mm-hmm. related site work.
Yep,
that's what Article 2 is,
right?
So and the so the I think the follow-up question first that everybody has is, so why?
Why?
We designed the school. It looked really good. The town meeting approved it. Why are we adding four classrooms at this stage? So I guess that's sort of why I'm here. Every year, one of the things the school committee gets is updated enrollment projections from a service that we work with, that most districts work with. And the school had been designed for an enrollment of 395 students in K and first grade. Mm-hmm. And based on our enrollment projections over most years, that looked like it would be the right number. It might be a little higher when it opened, but we had some flexibility, but then it would level off. As everyone, I don't think it's surprising to anybody that we've got a tremendous amount of growth in town right now. And our enrollment projections that we got this past November showed something very different. They showed a significant and continued growth in students in K and 1 to the point where we would be in a position where we would have larger classes in K and 1 in this new building over a sustained period of time. So, that's obviously not ideal when we're talking about 21, 22 kids in a kindergarten classroom. So we looked at what our options were in reacting to this.
Well, and I, just to kind of put an exclamation point on this is, if you had gone to the town at the onset and said, well, here are what the projected enrollment numbers are, but we think it's more than that, we want more, that's actually fiscally irresponsible, and it's and it doesn't bode well. And so I do understand you got a new set of information, and life changes daily. So every time you get information, it's wrong the next day. But this is the best estimate, and given what we have underway. So the good news is this information is not coming 2 years after the school opened and we're trying to then retrofit stuff. This is coming at a really great time.
Yeah, absolutely.
In terms of the time, I mean, it couldn't come at a better time for the foundation work.
Right.
And, you know, the way they've laid out the schools, they've done the auditorium, the cafeteria foundation, the kindergarten wing, the administration, and now they're working on the classrooms. And it was always part of the plan to have expansion for this school. Mm-hmm. The planning board required it, the MSBA required it, and the expansion was going to be just where we're talking about. It's fortunate that we have the special town meeting. The foundation there is not done. It's easy at this point. It's pretty much sliding the end wall out, sliding the new unit in, and should we have a satisfactory vote at the special town meeting, they'll get right to work on the foundation and finish it.
I think when you talk about what you're asking for in the scope of what we spend in the town and on schools and everything else, this is actually a very small ask. I think John and I were talking the other day that it's between $4 or $5 a household.
Well, and when you think about this, and correct me if I'm wrong, doing it now is probably a lot cheaper than doing it 2 years from now.
Doing it now is the most fiscally responsible way to do it. Where we are in the project budget right now, and we've always committed to be on budget and on time, we're now at a point where, due to the value engineering work the building committee did, plus savings and the bidding of concrete and steel and others that came in much more competitively than expected, we're now $2 million under budget. So we have an opportunity to apply budget that's already been allocated for the new school and apply that towards the addition, right?
So that's where. So the ask is actually a little less than the actual cost of that
addition. The cost is 3.5, but we're going for the delta between what we can apply from the savings
and the cost.
That's great.
Whereas, as you said, Connie, if we wait till after the building's constructed and we start it as a new process. Now, if you want to go through MSBA, that took us 2 or 3 years to get through for co-funding. If you want to do it yourself, either way, it's going to be, costs don't go down over time, right?
And you also have to factor in the fact that not only are we able to do this now from a fiscal perspective, it's advantageous, but if you waited until the building was finished and added on these classrooms, you'd be disrupting the students who are going to that school.
Right.
Putting a four-classroom addition on a building is not something that you can do without disrupting the building's operation.
And even in terms of numbers,
if enrollment even ever scaled down, it's not those classes would ever go to waste.
Right.
There's
right.
always need for more space and things to do in a school.
Absolutely.
So
and I think I think it's important to note too that when we talk about these enrollment projections, these are at least 10 years out that
That's
we're saying these
to.
Numbers
so
hold.
How many you had a projection or a due projection of 390? Roughly, how many kids do you think this can accommodate comfortably with hopefully a little wiggle room.
Yeah. So with the 13, this will give us 13 classrooms per grade level, and the projections have us going up, you know, towards the 470, 480 student level. You know, it depends on the year.
So ideally, you want about 18 kids in a classroom.
18 to 20 kids is our target enrollment or our target class size for kindergarten and first grade. Mm-hmm. One thing, since I've been on the school committee that has, and this has gone on longer than I've been there, Hopkinton has always been really strongly advocating smaller class sizes. This is something that's really important to the people in town. Mm-hmm. And so I think that's what, yeah, and especially at those younger ages.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was thinking ages, too. Yeah. Like, if these are gonna be your first experience in class, you don't wanna feel like a student's lost.
Right.
Yeah. It's hard to recover.
And so what you end up doing with those larger class sizes is people don't realize that you have the educational impact, but you also have the financial impact. Because if you have a class of 22 kindergartners, you probably need to put a full-time paraprofessional in there with the teacher.
In addition
And then you have space constraints. You have all these challenges in addition to the educational delivery to
students.
It's
a win-win. Absolutely.
And again, as Mike said, the timing couldn't be better. At the last two school committee meetings, I keep commenting on this as a tremendous opportunity we have.
It really came up
at the perfect time for us.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I mean, public construction projects are not known for being flexible.
yet
what you're seeing right now is a level of flexibility and adaptability that's almost, you know, unheard of in a public construction project. Mm. But it's due to the fortuitous timing of where we are, as Mike said, with the construction on site and having a town meeting that happened at Now, if we come back, if we had a town meeting 6 months from now, we wouldn't be able to do this. It's too late. We're too far ahead in the construction.
I mean, you'd have to do it, but it'd be a bigger ask, and it'd be a lot more problematic.
We would not be on schedule with the main project.
Just,
Then the addition would be a problem for the basic project. Yep. There'd be the tail wagging the dog. And we haven't mentioned it yet, but we partner with the MSBA, the Massachusetts School Building Authority. Mm-hmm. And they're you know, contributing over 40% of the construction costs of the school.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And they, like the planning board, wanted some expansion, and that's why we said, we have potential over here to add 8 classrooms. And somebody said the other day at the coffee shop, said, well, why don't we just add the 8 classrooms now? And the numbers just don't show we need 8. Mm-hmm. The numbers show we're gonna need 4, mm-hmm. and that's what we're doing. The other thing about additions is additions usually look like additions, and this, if we do it, will be seamless. Nobody will know where this thing started and the other thing ended.
Yeah.
And potentially 10 years from now, should things go the way they are, we could be talking about something else. But right now, it's kind of what we need, and the timing of the special town meeting is especially fortuitous.
Absolutely.
Because of a lot of things, where we are on the foundation primarily, and we don't have to, you know, remobilize anybody to come back. They're there right now, and so it'll work out good for us.
So we're going to be, you know, encouraging. We're all going to be there, and this is such an important special town meeting for lots of reasons, and this has been a real education in terms of what's going on, at least in
the
school
development. It's taken a long time to get some, you know, we have needed a solution for Center School for a long time, to finally get to something where the town agreed on it, and to know this is a small ask to get this done right.
Your comment about Center School solution, my daughter was 4 years old when this conversation started, and she is going to be 23.
So the perseverance.
For the most part, none of our kids. I mean, you might have a child,
but I'm all for
or something that might get one year out of the school. But for us, none of our kids are actually going to benefit for it. But we all got to benefit from really good schools. My kids got to benefit from two new schools.
This isn't our idea, right? We're here channeling the town's energy because they put us here to get this done finally.
And there's nothing better that we can invest in the town, really, than the school system and the education process.
I gotta tell you, whether you're thinking about house values, where you think about quality of life, it does revolve around the schools.
Well, let me punctuate this note. You know, the dedication of all of you in moving this forward, you know, for years, and just, you know, oftentimes I'm inspired just being on this couch with my friends and with guests in terms of the things that we do to, you know, improve our communities and participate. So I want to give a shout out to our girl Darlene here, who represented us and many others on the Boston Commons this past Saturday at the Women's March.
Oh, thanks.
Not related to the school, but in terms of just having a voice out there.
And it was a positive voice. I mean, I brought this. I mean, most of the messages were on love. I mean, there were tons of these hats. So shout out to Binky DeColibus, who made tons of them, and she put little charms on them. This one says hope. This was actually my 16-year-old daughter's. And, you know, it was neat to see. When you looked out, and I was in a press box, so I really was looking out, it was nearly 50-50 men and women that really want hope. And that was what it was all about. It was about love and hope and the environment.
And community.
And stuff like that. And there was nobody aggressive. There wasn't arrests. There was nobody violent.
I heard there wasn't even much trash to clean up.
There was, you know? No. There was a spot when people, I guess, would come around where you could actually put the signs at the end that was left on purpose for the media to be able to take some pictures for the next morning for people to reflect going by. And most of them went to the Boston Public Library that they're archiving. And the same thing happened in D.C. The Smithsonian took the signs. So there was a place, outside that I heard a whole bunch in New York went in front of somebody's hotel. But, and my son's girlfriend was actually, and a lot of Hopkinton people were in D.C.
Yeah, and my daughter went to D.C.
And it was very, even then, you know, they were mobbed, but it was peaceful.
Right. Mm-hmm. So, well, yeah, just well, before
and
we,
being
there.
Yeah. And I think.
Before we keep going on that, I did want to bring us back to, a special town meeting is Monday night, January 30th,
right?
And will continue probably through Tuesday night, January 31st. There are a number of articles up there for, and you can, they've been printed, they've been shared
online. They're posted.
And we can probably put something up on this show too with that info.
Town meeting, right. And please, you know, this is where your voice counts. This is a very, Darlene's sharing where her voice counted, but this is where our voice counts, and this is not a de minimis request. And if we had 1,000 of us show up, wouldn't that be a wonderful problem to have, that we have 1,000 of us and we have to overflow into the various rooms?
That we're not worried about making quorum at a meeting.
And we're not worried about making quorum.
There's a variety of things
so because
the charter
review. You know, this special town meeting was spurred by what you said, charter review. Mm-hmm. And if people don't realize, the town charter was established 10 years ago. It is our town's constitution. It is what has allowed us to have, you know, a town manager as part of our government structure. And there's a lot in that is the bulk of what special town meeting is.
Yes.
We're lucky to be able to vote and help, you know, build this four additional classrooms on the school. There's something on eminent domain, and I'm missing one.
There's another, is it a land act?
Yep. This is the eminent domain.
We'll get it all posted up.
But I mean, I think it is
seven
out
words.
There, and there's pros and cons for each issue. It's been kind of very much outlined on a lot of the publications.
We'll get the information out. We'll post information here, but pay attention to that. Hopefully, you'll come out Monday morning.
Yeah,
or
yeah.
Monday evening.
Monday evening.
Don't come out Monday morning.
Come in the morning, but you'll have a long way.
School's going to be going on.
Right, yeah. Exactly.
Yeah. I also really give a really big shout out to John. For someone who's only been in town 7 years, been on a committee for 5 of those 7, been involved pretty much from day one, I'm a town meeting junkie, and there's probably, you know, a couple dozen of us that are town meeting junkies. You've never not seen John there.
Yeah.
And that was before he was on boards. Mike and Joe
are
always there. And that, you know, new, I mean, there's been a lot of new families, and we're talking about, we need your vote for these new classrooms because you new families, it's your children.
Darlene, you know, and building off what Connie said too, last year was a presidential election year. A lot of people got into that remotely through Facebook or the news or whatever. This is where you can make a difference.
This is why
I got involved.
This is our backyard.
This is where we live, and we have the opportunity at town meeting to have an impact on our local communities.
Yeah.
If everyone did that, across America. Imagine what could happen.
Right. Amazing.
Right. Well said, Jen.
And, you know, and when people want to say, like, well, there was only 100, 150 people making distance to the town, I'm like, that's because you sat home on your couch.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
Come. And especially for the school issue, I can't emphasize enough. With the town growth, it is the new people who are going to benefit from the school. You need to be there to vote for it.
But I'm in that camp of maybe it'll be the 22nd century when we're able to have more. We don't have to all show up and sit in a room.
Oh, do it electronically.
Until 11 o'clock at night. But that's a big ask. But
yeah. the other thing, going off what Darlene just said, we all benefit from the schools.
Yep.
Yeah. Our entire community has benefited because at some point they decided we're going to have top-notch schools.
Right.
The people have always supported that. All the values of all our homes have increased.
That's why people move here.
Our kids go to better schools because of it.
And they end up in better colleges.
It isn't just little kids that
benefit. And our kids go to better colleges because of it. And the recruitment that happens at Hopkinton High School is huge. Yeah.
Quick little shout-out.
Very quick.
Physicals tonight?
Oh, yes. So, yeah. Interstage Left Theater Company is putting on Seussical the Musical tonight at the middle school. It's opening
through
night.
Through the weekend.
There are evening performances tonight and Saturday night, and matinee performances Saturday and Sunday. And I'm plugging this because I have two children who are in the show.
We always fund local
but
stuff.
But also because it's going to be a wonderful, fun show, very entertaining.
That's what this was all about.
It's a fun, colorful, fast-paced show. I came to emphasize, I mean, the last time the ESL did it was in 2011. My daughter wasn't at that. It is really worth seeing again.
Yeah. Anything else?
What else is going on in town this weekend?
Well, this weekend it's fairly quiet. We're preparing for Seussical. Seussical special town meeting. Next Friday is one of HEA's open mic night. Barbara Kessel will be featured.
Good live music.
And midweek
in town.
Next week, it's also the potential that we could have a third night special town meeting. Is actually the library and another organization are hosting a family astronomy night outdoors.
Oh, good. Wow.
That I know it's posted all over the place. You can call the library for more information on it, but that's going on. But I think and Tuesday night before the start of special town meeting, the Hopkinton Chamber of Commerce will have one of their networking nights, and that will be at Quattro.
Yep.
And
quick
we
shout
just
out
had Startline Breweries ribbon cutting yesterday, so they can pour pints.
Yep. And thanks to Pilates.
Perfect Fit Pilates
for hosting us recently for
last
our
week
rejuvenation
we were there.
Night. Had a great book club with Hank Philippi Ryan. A lot of things going on. Thanks for joining us, everybody.
And right. Thank you for having us.
Thank you.
See you at town meeting.
Possibility. It starts early, before we even know what it is. Thanks to people who make it happen. Together, we are possibility.